HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Eight Lives of a Century-Old Trickster, a novel by Mirinae Lee, performed by Cindy Kay. To my husband, my muse, and the greatest hero in my book. Prologue. The idea came to me while I was going through my divorce. I was 47 and overweight. I had no child who would occupy my lone, silent days. I wasn't one of those independent, modern women who decided not to have babies early on. I wanted to have one, but my husband couldn't, due to his oligospermia, he told me. I wanted to try IVF treatment, but he refused, saying the whole process felt too demeaning to him. I was furious later when I learned that he had already signed up to a famous fertility clinic in Gangnam with that new girl, 12 years his junior, a month before our divorce was finalized. For weeks, I had the occasional dream of hammering him to death. In reality, of course, I possessed neither the courage nor the penchant for violence to do it. Yet I did imagine myself bursting into his office in Gwanghwamun, like an angry Azuma in Korean morning drama might do to attack her cheating husband, hands busy filling the air with leaflets that detail his treacherous deeds, all the while shouting the list of his sins in front of his coworkers, who would ostracize him for what he'd done. Of course, I never executed this fantasy. Submitting to such a hysterical course of action would be too demeaning to my dignity. Entertaining the thought of it, though, was quite thrilling. I was desperately seeking a change in my life. I signed up for a gym and worked out for an hour 3 days a week. Although I began to lose weight and feel healthier, the physical change alone wasn't enough for me. Ever since I was little, I've been a pensive being, fond of reading and thinking and scribbling things down in my moleskin. I needed more than just a fitter body. I needed a change that would engage my mind as well. I was waiting for an appointment with my therapist and flipping through a women's magazine when I saw the article. It was the story of a hospice doctor in Singapore who helped his dying patients organize their funerals and write their obituaries before their death. Contrary to common belief, the doctor explained, many of his terminally ill patients weren't that afraid of death. They were more concerned about the aftermath, the posthumous grief and turmoil that their loved ones were to endure. His new program was met with a surprising degree of enthusiasm. Lots of patients reported they felt mentally and physically better after they had participated in the arrangements for their passing. It gave them a sense of control and reassurance, and an invaluable opportunity to derive their own meaning from their short journeys on Earth. I showed this article to Director Hum, my boss, and told her I wanted to launch a similar program for our patients. I couldn't really complain about my job at the Golden Sunset. The salary was pretty decent, the company guaranteed plenty of paid holidays, and my schedule and tasks were never taxing. What I mostly did was a mild version of accounting, but my official title was personal assistant to the director. Director Hum was a nice woman in her early 50s, a double divorcee raising her three kids with two different family names. She didn't seem to possess much passion for her job at the Golden Sunset. She told me she'd chosen it mainly for its stability, which she needed badly as a single mother of three children. Director Hum tapped her desk nervously with her blood-red nails before she declared the Golden Sunset had no funding for custom-made funeral preparations. I told her the obituary writing program alone would be sufficient to make a change. Though reluctant, she gave me permission to start it after I promised her that it wouldn't affect my performance of my primary duties, and that I would work extra hours if necessary. Before leaving the office, she threw me a worried look, as if she were thinking, I've been there too. But instead, she said, give me a call if you need a drinking buddy from time to time. As I listened to the clicks of her heels fade away, I wondered if divorce would be any easier the second time around. The obituary writing program first helped me on a practical level. It diverted my attention from divorce. My thoughts, which until now had raced back to my husband and our fallen marriage again and again like a faithful dog, began to dwell on the lives of others. "I'm here to help you write your obituary," I told the elderly, in the most calming voice I could muster. "You can tell me a brief version of your life story, things that have made you happy, things that you're proud of, and things that you regret, how you want to be remembered by others, those who love you and care about you." After taking a few deep breaths, most people began to open up quite naturally. Awareness of your limited time can bring a surprising degree of honesty to your speech by shutting off the inconsequential background noises that would normally obfuscate your life. To the small number of people who had difficulty starting their stories, I offered a simple prompt that always worked. Pick three words, noun, adjective, verb, anything, that could define you or best describe your life. Three is the magical number that people tend to fall for. A single word seems impossibly limiting, while two may feel unpalatable, as if they imply a double life. But three suggests a perfect balance, as in triumvirate and trilogy and trinity. People feel comfortable with it, neither too little nor too much. Looking ahead to the end of their lives, people feel the urge to leave their footprints on this world, no matter how small they may be. And writing their obituaries confirms that their lives mattered to them and to the people for whom they had happily sacrificed their dreams. In the minds of youth, an obituary is a sad and solemn thing. But old folks understand that it means, among other things, a privilege. Old folks, who are used to flipping through the pages of a newspaper, know that an official obituary is reserved for the deaths of household names. Even the famous ones must fight constantly for ever so cramped space. Most should be content with just a couple of lines, while a very lucky few get an entire paragraph. A whole page is, of course, impossible unless you're a high-profile politician, such as an ex-president or an internationally influential warlord. At the golden sunset, however, every death merits an entire page. That was the central idea of my project. Don't we all deserve a full obituary of our lives? I wanted to believe that every death and life, even the most obscure and inconvenient ones, have important stories to tell. And I was there to lend my ears and pen to the final whistles of the tumbleweeds. It was the second day of the Lunar New Year holiday when I met Ms. Mook for the first time. I had volunteered to work since I wasn't ready to face my first big family gathering after the divorce. I knew the kinds of questions I would get from my uncles and aunts, and especially my cousins, all of whom were still happily married with kids. I wasn't ready for others to pick at my scabs yet. A public nursing home might be the loneliest place on earth on a big national holiday. More than a third of the residents at Golden Sunset had no immediate families. A small number of fortunate people, though still in decent health and in touch with caring relatives, were invited out for a day or two. After the lucky few left the facility, a harrowing silence took over. The kind of quiet that put even the jumpiest dementia patients into a coma-like gloom. That evening, in the lonely silence of my office, I received a call from the head caretaker of Section A. It houses nearly half of the senior citizens of Golden Sunset who have been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Normally, I didn't have much business with that half of the facility because only the mentally competent and coherent can participate in the obituary writing process. That day, however, many staff members were on leave, so I was to help with whatever task was at hand. I was asked to stand guard in front of a double room. Grandma Sung Jae-sun had disappeared again, the head caretaker told me. My job was to wait and notify the other staff immediately if the runaway returned to her room while they searched every nook and cranny of Golden Sunset for her. I wedged the door open with the small folding chair I'd brought from my office and sat down on it. Walkie-talkie in hand, I looked up and down the corridor, hoping for a sign of Grandma Sung Jae-sun. Then I saw a figure standing inside the room, her back leaning against the wall. A slender woman, covered with white from head to toe. I let out a muffled cry. "Don't worry, I'm not a ghost," murmured the figure, and laughed off-key. "You saw me earlier, remember?" Her name was Muk Miran, and she was a roommate of Grandma Song. I had indeed seen her when I visited her room. She'd been in her bed, slowly coming around from her late nap. I didn't recognize her. She was quite tall standing up, but lying down, she was indistinguishable from other silent and small-framed elderly bodies. "You're the obituary woman, aren't you?" She grinned, and color rushed to her face. Muk Miran was a strange-looking woman with an equally strange name. It was my first time meeting a Korean with the last name Muk. She had big frizzy hair, which was entirely and evenly white, and it hung around her head like a halo. Her limbs were long and thin like a snow crab's. Under the fluorescent light, I felt I could read her body like a map. Veins showed through her translucent skin, like crisscrossed mountain paths, mostly mauve and pale blue. The bleaching light also drew a pair of butterfly-like shadows under her high cheekbones. "Yes, I'm the obituary woman," I answered, still in awe of her. "I've seen you out there in the cosmos garden, talking with the old ones," said Ms. Mook. She called the other patients the old ones, as though she was different. And yet, with her sharp eyes and her memory of me, I wondered what she was doing in Section A. "You should write my obituary," she said, revealing a chipped front tooth. I hid my bewilderment and told her we could have our talk right now if she didn't mind, while we waited for the return of her roommate. I was surprised by the clarity of her mind, but I was still wary of her. I assumed that if the administration had decided to put her in the section for patients with Alzheimer's, they must have had a good reason for it. "Do you remember why you're here in Section A?" I started, a little ruthless, because I wanted to know if this was going to be worth my while. I didn't want to come back to her the next week and be greeted with a flummoxed face shouting, "Who the hell are you?" Ms. Mook said she had been in the regular section at first, but they'd moved her here about 6 months ago, for a reason she never fully understood. "I would say my mind works normally, but it's up to them to decide, isn't it?" she whispered. Her cheeks twitched. "Still suspicious?" I asked her the big first question. "Which three words would you choose to sum up your life?" She walked back to her bed and sat down on it. Then she turned her head slowly toward a wall and stared at it. Her face was blank, as flat and pale as the whitewashed wall behind her, mouth slack, eyes ashen. She's blacking out, I thought, anticipating the inevitable. Soon she would bring her gaze back to me and ask me who I was, what I was doing here. Instead, I heard a snort. "You genuinely believe a person can sum up her life in just three words?" she murmured, eyes still fixed on the wall. Her question caught me off guard, but I feigned calm. After a moment of silence, I asked her how many words she would prefer. "What would your three words be? Have you thought about that?" Again, she asked her question, ignoring mine. I felt strangely tense. I felt as though Grandma Mook and I were suddenly engaging in a war of questions, and the one who answered first would be the loser. I summoned a wan smile, the gentle curving of eyes and lips with no teeth showing, the kind I usually wore to disarm incredulous grandpas. I was doing this partly because I couldn't answer her last question. I had no idea what my three words would be. I'd never given it a thought, although I asked it of others all the time, and no one had asked me before. "Ms. Mook, do you want me to talk to the administration for you?" I asked her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.